Welcome back to RG Geek. Maybe you're thinking, I've got one of these like emulator handhelds and I'd like to have this kind of experience on my TV, because why would I want to play PlayStation games, for example, on this tiny device when I can play it on my 4K TV? So, but you want an experience like here, like simple menu where you can just go through the games with box art and play what you want that way. So today I'm going to show you how you can do this. So I have an Android TV box down here. You can see it down here. It's that little box down there powering all this. That costs you about 50 bucks on Amazon. So you can load up an app on here called LibreELEC. And actually all this does is says reboot from the SD card slot. And then this will boot up EmuELEC, which I have installed on the SD card. I have a 200 gigabyte micro SD card installed in the device. And it'll now reboot from Android OS to distro Linux here. You see I'm running 3.8. It's a beta version right now. By the time you watch this, 3.8 is likely to be stable. But I'm quite happy with it already. This is where they switched over to a 64-bit version as well. And I've hooked up this Bluetooth controller to it, the 8-bit Do SN30 Pro Plus. There, it's paired. I push a button and go right in. This is my personal favorite UI, the Supreme. And you just go down, you pick the system you want, you go in. And you even have videos you can set up in the corner there. And you have different UIs you can pick as well. You don't have to have this one, but I like this retro feel. Like one other that I like a lot is the comic book style. And it changes just like that. You have a completely different UI. And there's thousands of these themes that you can find to get the exact look that you want. And you can also edit the themes, of course. It's all open source. So, and I love that it's all at your fingertips. You can also plug in USB controllers. You don't have to have a Bluetooth controller, so it depends on if you want really no lag experience, you can plug in your USB controllers. If you want more convenience, you can use a Bluetooth controller as you wish. And also have bezels on here. So just a note with my system, Saturn doesn't work very well, just a few games. I got two games working on it. Dreamcast works surprisingly well, but not every game. And I only got a few PSP games to work. So the S905X3 chip, I find it works everything perfectly up through PlayStation. And then some other systems you can fool around a bit, try to get some settings, but I find just run the systems that run well, and I'm happy with that. So, and you can also see here, let's just run through a game here. If we pick, say, Stunt Race FX. This also has the bezel project integrated into it as well. So you can see you get these beautiful bezels on the sides. This is even more pronounced in the arcade games. So, let's see, I hit hotkey start twice to leave. And I'll show you really quick what I mean by the arcade bezels. We go down to, say, for example, Ms. Pac-Man. This is just, I think this is gorgeous, and it looks like surprisingly modern on a HDTV. Two beautiful bezels on the side, just like you would in the arcade. Oops, I meant to show you the game. Let's go back in. Everything runs pretty seamlessly, as you can see here. So select insert coin, start to play, and there's the game starts up. Looks gorgeous on here. And so one thing that surprised me too is not only does it have these, for the rare widescreen game, You can see this even has a bezel for a dual screen game, which I think is super cool. So then you play this widescreen game on your widescreen TV, and you have little bezels on the bottom and top. So let me just, I will explain to you what I think are the best things to buy to have this kind of setup, and then you can decide for yourself if you want to download EmuELEC and install it yourself as well. So I'm super happy with this, I have to say. Oh, before I leave the TV now, I'm going to go back out here and just show you that a little bit around the menu. So you can go the main menu. So you've got a main menu. At each system, you have system menus as well. So you can even do game options specifically or system options. Let's go back out here. So you got the like your basic settings as well. Game settings. So if you say FTP ROMs in, you can just update them here. You can change the aspect ratio, if you want the bezels or not, and so forth. And for some handhelds, I have also integer scaling, so you get perfect scaling. And here you can even go in and like set specific options for each platform. So like here, on many of them, I have the CRT scanline shader set as well, so it looks more like an old style TV. Oh, I'll just go down quickly to here, show you I'm running 3.8 test and so much disk space I'm using and so forth. So it's your time zone, that's a new feature in 3.8, your language and so forth. So one thing I'd like as well is if you want to get back to your Android box, you just say reboot from NAND. And it saves metadatas and goes right back to the Android box. So you basically can run two systems off here. You've got the Android on one side and you've got your EmuELEC on the other. All right, so let's get into what I recommend buying if you want this kind of setup. You'll need an Android TV box, a micro SD card, and at least one game controller, a wired one that is. At least to set it up. So, let's start with the Android TV box. I went for the HK1 box. She can come in with either 32 gigs, 64 gigs, or 128 gigs of space. But that's actually completely immaterial because you won't be using it for EmuELEC. It's more if you actually want to use the Android TV box, you can buy different quantities of space. So from what I saw recently, it's about $50 on Amazon.com. And the 64 gig model is like $4 more than the 32 gig model, so you might as well at least get the 64 gigs. You could put movies on there or use it for Android gaming, although to be honest, I haven't been that impressed by it so far. The main key thing to know is that you want at least 2 gigabytes of RAM. This one comes with 4. You'll also want to check, sometimes there's a micro SD limit. Interestingly enough, that limit applies to Android. So if you see a 64 gigabyte SD card limit on the box, that means that for Android, that's the limit. Which also has a side effect that if you have a card larger than 64 gigs, you won't be able to see it when you're on the Android side. But I have a 200 gig card and I'm quite happy with it, honestly. So you also get this remote with it, you get some kind of remote. We'll talk about if you want to upgrade your remote experience later. As for the box itself, you also want to make sure it has one of the following chipsets: the S905, S912, S905X2, S905X3, S922X, or the A311D. Now, the best of these, in my opinion, is the S922X, but at that point you could be getting into the cost of double or three times what this one would cost. So yeah, those machines will be like starting at maybe $100, $120, $150. And I mean, for my purposes, this cheap one's just fine. If I ever decide to want to upgrade in the future, I can always just buy another one. So Yeah, so I'd recommend the S905X3 boxes to get the best bang for your buck. They'll run pretty much everything up to PlayStation. They'll run a couple Saturn games. They'll run Dreamcast pretty well. You won't have much luck with N64. A few PSP games. But if you just think of it as like running up to the original PlayStation, then you're good to go. There's a lot of games. So, let's get onto the micro SD card. I just have a typical SanDisk. I hear the Extremes are better, and there's other cards too you can get. But I've been quite happy with just this one right here, and this one only cost me 25 euros. So it's like 27 bucks. And that stores a ton of games on it, obviously. So, I mean, you really only need bigger cards when you want to put like PlayStation and the CD games, basically. So let's get into controllers. So he recommends the best wired controller. If you want to get a wired controller just for this, is the Logitech F310. And that's the one that the actual developer of this system uses himself. So that's obviously the best one to go for. But I do have, for example, this old Logitech controller lying around. I got about 15 years ago. It works fine, except for some reason the analog sticks aren't recognized in the system, even when I toggle the button here. But, I mean, for everything up to, I mean, even the original PlayStation controllers didn't have analog sticks. So I still play most of the games, although I don't like the feel of it too much. I mean, yeah, not too happy. And also it doesn't feel very ergonomic on the other side. What I actually recommend personally is I recommend the 8-bit Duo Pro Plus Bluetooth controller. And I really like this. It looks a lot like a Super Nintendo controller here. So, and you've got this button I've never actually used with this. It's a favorites button for Switch, if I'm not mistaken. And one nice thing about this is you can use this with pretty much any system. So when you turn it on, you hit like start Y, put in Switch mode, which is also the mode you'll want to connect to EmuELEC. Start X is Windows mode, start A is Mac mode, and start B is Android mode. So if you put start B, you can start it when you're booted into your Android on your TV, and start Y if you're booted into your EmuELEC, so it's very versatile that way. And also start A would work on iOS devices, like an iPhone, iPad, and it works great. And I set this one up as my hotkey. So for when I want to leave a game, I'll hit home start twice, and then I leave the game. And it's also got the analog triggers as well, not just digital triggers. And that's the pairing button over there. But I'm super happy with this. One unfortunate thing was I did get one of these and I dropped it, and after the first drop it wouldn't pair anymore. So I'm actually sending that back to Amazon, unfortunately. But other than that, I've been very happy with these controllers. I got two of them. And these also come in black if you prefer a more modern look than a retro look. Another nice thing about this system is you can even connect actual, authentic controllers. So here you can play Super Nintendo games with actual, these are the American Super Nintendo controllers, the real thing, Nintendo, as you see this. And then you can get these adapters. You just plug them right in on even two sides. So I plug the other controller in as well. And suddenly you've got yourself a portable Super Nintendo you can take with you anywhere you want. So, and it works great. And here I have the hotkey set up to just select start. So hit select start twice. And one thing to note too, when you're in the game, you can use the hotkey X to get into RetroArch controls. Start select B, or hotkey B is a reset. And then hotkey R1 is save. L1 is load. And you can even use hotkey up and down to switch save states. And if I'm not mistaken, hotkey left and right even rotate your screen. But if you're doing TV gaming, that's probably not gonna be important to you.
unless you can actually rotate your TV, which I imagine some of you actually have crazy setups where you can actually do that, so you can play portrait gaming. So we've gotten the controllers out of the way, and pretty much any Bluetooth controller will work too. So it's just a matter of, do you want lag? Do you want the authentic controller experience? I mean, it's pretty much whatever you want. You can just set it up as you like. One thing to note is that once you connect a controller, it pretty much stays in that slot. So if you want to, say, you're playing Super Nintendo, you want to switch to playing, like, I don't know, PlayStation, then you probably want to restart Emulation Station. Well, unplug this first. So it's just a typical USB-A connection, as you imagine. You just unplug this first, and then you restart Emulation Station, and then connect your Bluetooth controller again, and you're good to go. So, one last thing is remote controls. The biggest problem with this remote control is that it is IR-based. So, trouble is being that if you want to move your cursor on the screen, you've got to be pointing it directly at the box, which is a pain. And also, it could be that you have some kind of like projector system where the box is behind you, so reaching back over your head isn't really a great option. And also, it's you can't type anything, you see here. So I went for a Wii Chip, I think it's about 20 bucks, Wii Chip Air Mouse, and I love it. The only weird thing is when you push a button, that sort of wakes it up. But on the other hand, that gives you amazing battery life. So just remember, you push a button to start it, and then it's ready to go. So here it is, it's nice and sleek. It even has a similar aesthetic to that, a little shinier. It goes better with like my Apple TV remote and things like that. But you've got your up, down, left, right, and it's pretty standard. It's home, back. Here's an air pointer, an air mouse actually, is where you actually push it, and then you'll be controlling a mouse cursor on the screen, which is totally useful for getting around an Android TV. And this is your right click for the mouse, and voy up and down. What's really neat about this, though, is the full keyboard on the back. So you can type things like searching YouTube, searching Netflix, whatever you want, or even typing in file names if you want to try to do emulation directly on the Android TV. I didn't have much luck with that. I found it was too laggy, but if you want to, it's there. The only trouble I had with this particular box is that for some reason the enter key wasn't working, and I heard that's quite common for a lot of these boxes. I tried a fix, it worked until I rebooted it. So, but I just need to look more into it to figure out how to make that permanent. Probably need to run some kind of like startup script or something. It's a real pain that it didn't come out of the box with the enter key working. And that's a problem with the box, not the air mouse. But all in all, I've been very happy with this. So I highly recommend it. They have a later version of this as well. Well, for one thing, it's bigger and it has the number keys, which I don't really care for. I think it even has a Netflix button, if I'm not mistaken. But you can look at reviews if you see it, but I myself prefer this. It's a sleeker, more minimal experience. And also smaller if you want to take it on the go. So pretty much the idea then is I use this to control the Android box when it's in Android mode, and then I use this to control it when it's in EmuELEC Linux mode. And I'm quite happy with that solution. I tried connecting it when it was in connecting this in EmuELEC, and it wanted to treat as a game controller, and I was like, oh, I don't want it to be recognized as a gamepad, so I won't set it up. And this also comes with a dongle here, which you can put in the USB 2.0 port here. But you can recognize the 3.0 port because it's blue. And the 2.0 port here, because you don't need speed for this. So, and it just sticks out like that, no problem. All right, so this should be all you need to get a good idea of what you want to get if you get a, if you want to set up EmuELEC for yourself. And I wish you happy gaming. If you like this, please like, subscribe. If you have ideas for other videos you'd like to see, especially about EmuELEC, there isn't that much out there right now. So just let me know in the comments below. Thank you very much. Have a great one.